Thanks for joining us. My name is Porter McRoberts, and this is Melissa Lee. I'm a interventional pain physician here at Holy Cross Hospital in South Florida. And please go to our website at internationalhouseofpain.com if you want to see more videos. Today we're going to be talking about the Nevro spinal cord stimulator and the Nevro trial system. And so we've had a lot of questions from patients about how the trial goes, what's involved, who the right patient is, who isn't, what to expect, and all those kinds of things. And I thought this is a great way, Melissa, as well, to explain to you guys what to expect and what we want to get accomplished. So we're going to have just an informal chat, and hopefully you guys are going to learn something. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. McRoberts, one of the most common questions that I receive is, who is the right candidate for a high-frequency neurostimulator?
So just a little background, you already know this, but high frequency is very different than a traditional tonic spinal cord stimulator. And so what happens with high frequency is that instead of the normal frequency somewhere around 1,000 or commonly much, much less, 60, 30, 50, 200 cycles per second, the Nevro high frequency spinal cord stimulator is at 10,000, which is very different. And it's different because our physiology, our spinal cord respond differently. The right patient is someone who is had chronic pain and has pain really from a malformation or misworking of the pain sensing system. That's why I explain it to patients usually. The Nevro device really works on the parts of the spinal cord that inappropriately increase or produce pain and send that sensation to the brain. And that's really what it works best on. It does not work on things like stubbing your toe or things that are appropriate that your pain system might report, like arthritis, or you got shot in the foot, you stub your toe, you have an infection. Those things, all those normal pain signals will come through. What the Nevro does, the high frequency, is it works on the neuron that is essentially the traffic cop or the director who then sends that signal up into the brain. Often that's where the biggest problem is with chronic pain, is in an area where the spinal cord then decides to send pain inappropriately or increase the amount of pain inappropriately before it sends it to the brain. So a patient who's appropriate is someone who's having chronic pain, who's not responded to normal appropriate therapies, for which there is no other normal or good surgical solution which has a high chance of success or is low risk. And so those patients are appropriate. Furthermore, we talk about something called neuropathic pain. Neuropathic pain is pain which comes from the nerve or the pain sensing system, be it the spinal cord, be it the peripheral nervous system. It's pain which is often characterized as burning or shooting or lancinating, or pain that's there all the time. Normal pain, we all have felt it, stubbing your toe or feeling something hot. It won't treat that kind of pain. It's only chronic pain of a nerve or a nerve impairment nature. So those are the best folks. It does also treat other types of pain, but just not as well. The best patient is someone who has chronic pain from malformation or mismatch of the pain sensing system.
How long does a patient typically do a trial with your office, and what are some of the restrictions that they may be asked to consider?
That's a good question as well. Trialing is varied, and a lot of different physicians do it in different ways. Generally, what we all need to do is provide enough time so that the patient can test drive this system to know if it's going to work for them or not. And usually, since the Nevro takes a little time to get working, it's at least 5 days, sometimes as much as 10 days. Occasionally, the system will really start working right away and the patient will have pain relief. But the way the Nevro works is that it works by desensitizing. It doesn't work immediately like a local anesthetic does, where it just stops the system, the pain sensing system, from working and causes numbness. This is very different, and for the actual chemical effect of the high frequency to work, it takes time, sometimes even days, before it works. And this, while extremely effective, can complicate things. Patients always want relief right away, as does everybody. That generally doesn't happen, and so a modicum of patience is required. So once we implant the lead, the trial lead, which is just putting the little wire in the back, just like a pregnant lady gets a catheter for having a baby, It's about the same procedure. That they go home with. It's coming out and they then go through a program. We target a certain portion of the cord where we know that the majority of the crosstalk between the peripheral nerves and the central nerves before they head up to the brain and the thalamus are. And it's around T9, T10, that area. But before we see effect, the patient has to wear and get the therapy for a little while. There's a burn-in time, kind of like when you start eating, you don't feel full right away. And it's the same thing with the stimulator. So we want at least amount of time so that the patient has a good trial run. What can happen is, at the first go, the patient may not get success because there are nuances or differences in our own anatomy. And while it might be T9, 10 for you, it might be T10 for me, or maybe even T11. And so we need enough time, and since we don't get the feedback right away, to patiently cycle through these spots to really see if we can find what we call the sweet spot. Once we find the sweet spot, then there's generally a clinical effect and a whole lot of pain relief. It's also important that in traditional spinal cord stimulation, where you feel a paresthesia, a buzz or a numbness from the actual stimulation, with the Nevro, you don't at all. So you really lack that type of feedback, which is disconcerting to some people and even physicians. But patience is required because sometimes you just wait, try enough programs, and all of a sudden the clouds part and magic occurs.
You typically tell patients to limit bending, lifting, twisting, and even keep their bandages dry. Why do you ask them that?
Well, good question. The bandages dry is simple and easy, as are the others. We've got a foreign object, which is this little spaghetti, which has now been passed into the back and is coming out through the skin, which means that there is a wound opening. And we've done it sterilely under a surgical sterile field. We've then prepped and closed the wound, and then we've placed a bandage over it. The whole idea is to keep it clean. We do not want anything foreign getting into the body through this little tiny opening. It may be only a millimeter wide, but it's enough that, say, a little bacteria or something could get in there. That's why we keep patients on antibiotics during the trial, and it's why cleanliness matters, always matters. But things like bathing, you may bathe as long as you are 100% sure you're going to keep this area dry and clean. No submerging, no swimming, no getting in the ocean, no mud wrestling, none of those things, obviously. So you can bathe as long as you can keep this reliably dry. And if you can patch it off with a piece of cellophane or a saran wrap and then tape it to the body, you could actually have a shower. But that's the main reason. The bending and twisting part, since it's coming through the skin, that skin will move up and down relative to the spine. And if we're, say, programming here at the fifth electrode, and that is right on the spot, if the patient's doing a lot of bending and twisting, it can move out of the sweet spot or away from it. And that may need more reprogramming. Let's say we were programming at T910 where we wanted to, happened to be electrode 5. You're getting success, the patient moves, now they're not getting success anymore, and we don't really know why. That bending and twisting is what moves this lead around a lot. So while we want patients to be active and really test what they're able to do, because that's the whole point of the trial, you know, if what they're doing is starting lawnmowers and lifting weights off the floor, that's not going to work. So they need to do things that, everything that they do other than the bending and twisting.
Okay. The last question that is common for many patients is, do I need to stop taking my pain medication to test if the stimulator is helping my pain?
I tell patients don't stop. And the reason is, generally, you know, pain medicine is kind of like sunglasses on a sunny day. It doesn't turn it to night. It just takes some of the pain away. But the stimulator is much like that. It may not take all the pain away. And we want to change only one variable at a time. If we change a bunch of variables, we won't know what's working. And if a patient stays on a lot of medicine, they stop the medicine, and then they go on the trial and their pain's the same, they may see that as being a no change. Conversely, if they go up on their medicine, they may think that the trial is working, and it's not. It's really the medicine that they increased. So I want them to keep all the variables pretty much the same during the trial so they can evaluate what the one new variable is, and that's the spinal cord stimulator lead, the Nevro lead.
So as a summary, you like patients to continue their everyday activity using caution with bending, lifting, and twisting, keeping their bandage completely dry, and maintain their current pain management regimen as prescribed.
That is precisely what we want.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other questions?
Well, what happens at the end of the trial? Does the patient go straight into the implant? What happens?
Well, That's another good question. What we are asking at first is not whether the spinal cord system will be good. We're not implanting the patient yet. The trial is the only thing in medicine that really allows a patient to try something. You can't have a trial back surgery, you can't have a trial pill. Everything else in medicine, for the most part, you've got to dive in with both feet, the whole body. The trial allows us to really see, test without the implant being put in us, what it's like. At the end of the trials, when we make that decision whether to go on and have the actual implant. So at the conclusion of the trial, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the lead out, which is very simple, make a little nick and just remove the suture. The lead slides right out of the spine. But at that point, we'll also be able to test what it was like during the trial compared to not having the trial. Because in that day or two, things will revert back to normal and you have a very clear juxtaposition of what it's like with the stimulator versus what it's like without. Usually, a lot of patients, most patients, immediately want it. In our practice, they need to wait a little bit. I want people to heal up any chance of bacteria in there. I want to be removed. I want the body to remove that. I want them to seal. So I generally ask them to wait about 2 weeks before we go to implant. Sometimes the process is a little longer getting them on the operative schedule, but usually about 2 weeks. There are ways which physicians will trial with the permanent lead, and in those instances, they can really go right to trial, but that's what's done usually in Europe. The issue with that is that the incidence of infection is somewhere around almost 20 to 25% when you go that way as opposed to remove it immediately, where now it's around 4% or less here in the U.S.
Thank you. I think you've covered all of our questions that are common to patients regarding the Nevro trial system.
Great. Thank you.